the moon. Let me play among the stars. Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, hold my hand.
Perhaps telescoping will be again in our future. We're confident. We got a lot of telescopes around LPL getting some dust on them, right? So hopefully they get some action. All right, so I'm going to introduce our next speaker, and then we'll be able to go into her presentation. And again, feel free to drop those questions in the chat, and we'll do them all at the end. So I'm excited to announce Dr. Jessica Barnes, who is an assistant professor at the Lunar and Planetary Laboratory, researching the origin and evolution of volatiles in the inner solar system. She uses electron microscopy to study lunar samples returned from the Apollo missions to the moon. Dr. Barnes is also a sample science collaborator for NASA's OSIRIS-REx mission. And you've probably heard me broadcast OSIRIS-REx several times, which is a mission to the asteroid Bennu. We are about a month away from actually acquiring that sample. If all goes well, praise the cosmos, it goes well. And Dr. Barnes will be one of the sample scientists that will actually get to physically work with that sample upon arriving back in Earth in 2024, I think is the number in my head. But we're going to go ahead and go into the video, and I will bring everyone back online after. I hope you enjoy.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Dr. Jessica Barnes. I'm an assistant professor at the Lunar and Planetary Lab at the University of Arizona. Thank you for joining me on International Observe the Moon Night. I'm really happy tonight to talk about the scientific value of lunar samples. Now, planetary science is focused on trying to understand the composition and content of our solar system, trying to assess what processes are happening on the surfaces and interiors of planetary bodies, and ultimately trying to understand how the planetary system we have today was formed and evolved. What are its origins? We can learn an awful lot about a planetary body by remote observation, either from Earth through telescopes or from orbit around a celestial body. We can also learn a lot about a planetary surface by going and visiting it robotically. But for a planetary geologist, samples and being able to study those samples is really crucial to ground truthing what we learn from those other methods. Samples returned to Earth really offer us an opportunity to use advanced analytical techniques only available on Earth to unravel the origin and evolution of those planetary bodies. And those studies just are not possible at the moment on other bodies because we can't ship those types of instruments and laboratory equipment on spacecraft. Now, lunar science is truly grounded by the information we've gained from lunar samples, whether Apollo or lunar samples or even lunar meteorites. The chemistry of Apollo samples helps us to constrain density models, for example, for lunar crustal thickness constraints. We find exogenous material in Apollo and lunar samples that informs us about the types of materials that were impacting the Earth-Lunar system through time. Apollo samples also provide information on the geological and geochemical makeup of the moon, and that in turn informs our models of how the moon formed and evolved, and maybe how other similar sized bodies may have formed too. From studying brecciated material, like the sample shown in the middle of the screen, we learn a lot about impact processes and how those affect and change the surfaces of the moon. When we think about studying lunar samples on Earth, we're really talking about two main things. We're talking about either studying meteorites or we're studying samples that have been brought back through sample return. Meteorites are really a free sample that fall to Earth after impact. They fall to Earth after an impact with the moon sends material into Earth crossing orbit. We collect meteorites on the surface of the Earth, either as witnessed or observed falls, or we go out and find them in hot and cold deserts. Meteorites are really an excellent complement to the lunar and Apollo and Luna samples because they represent an effective random sampling of the lunar surface. And as we'll see in a second, they sample areas outside of the regions that we've already visited. The other non-free way to get lunar samples is to go to the surface and bring back samples, either robotically or crewed. And that's really going to be our focus tonight. A total of 9 lunar missions returned samples from the lunar surface between 1969 and 1976. As we all know, there were 6 crewed Apollo missions, 11, 12, 14, 15, 16, and 17. And they collectively brought back a lot of material, 382 kilograms of lunar material. Whereas the 3 robotic lunar missions that operated over a similar time brought back only about 300 grams of material. And the difference in the return mass is really a direct result of having humans versus robots on the surface, and also having the ability, in the case of the later Apollo missions, 15 through 17, having the ability to traverse larger areas with a rover. So crucially, all of these sample return missions return materials from the near side of the moon, as you see depicted in this graphic. There have so far been no missions to the poles or to the far side of the moon. And so in some ways, although we visited several different sites on the surface of the moon, we're fairly geographically and geologically restricted in what we've been able to access and bring back to Earth, and also in turn, what we've been able to learn from the moon. We've learned a lot, but as you'll see later on, there are lots of things we still don't understand fully. And so tonight I'm going to focus on 2 Apollo missions and tell you a little bit about some of the major findings that we've had from samples from those 2 missions. And we'll start off with Apollo 11. So Apollo 11, as you all know, landed in the Mare Tranquillitatis region, or Sea of Tranquility, on the lunar near side in 1969. And here's a beautiful Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter camera image of the Apollo 11 landing site. You see it on the right. You can see the position of the lunar module, which is indicated by LM, or LEM as it's traditionally called. And here's a photograph from the Apollo era and from that mission of the LEM on the surface. You can also see in these really high resolution images, the astronaut tracks, where they traveled on the surface. You can see their movements as they're deploying experimental packages and taking photographs and collecting samples. Overlaying on the left side of the screen are the tracks that those 2 astronauts, Buzz Aldrin in blue and Neil Armstrong in orange, the tracks that they made while they were doing those operations on the surface. Now, this was the very first lunar mission to the surface with humans, and they didn't have a lot of time to explore. They only had about 2.5 hours. And so with no roving vehicle, they didn't really get very far from the LEM. This is illustrated in more easy to imagine terms if you look at this diagram or this figure. And so this is the same Apollo 11 tracks to scale overlaying on the Intrepid Sea Air and Space Museum in New York City. And you can just see that they didn't get very far. Despite that, the samples that Aldrin and Armstrong collected and brought back proved vital for not only setting the stage for huge discoveries about how the moon formed and evolved, but those samples are still being studied today and revealing new insights as we study them with new techniques. They're giving us new insights into the moon's history. I'm going to talk about one particular example of how Apollo 11 samples have helped constrain new insights into how we think the moon formed. And the example I'm going to give is Apollo 11 soils. Now, when we look up at the moon, even from Earth, we see 2 different terrains. We see a darker terrain and a lighter terrain. And very simply, these represent 2 different geological units. The darker regions are the mare, the volcanic regions, and the highlands represent the crust. Now, even before Apollo 11, some researchers had already postulated that the mare would be lava lakes, or lava seas, and that the highlands could be the original crust of the planetary body. Upon the return of Apollo 11 samples and studying those in the lab, like the one you see here, it was revealed that actually these these soil samples contain a wide variety of different rock types or lithic clasts. And you can see the example that we've got here, they range in size. These are quite small or fine-grained materials, only a couple to few millimeters in diameter. But crucially, they're made up of different materials. I've indicated two different types here. We've got basaltic material as indicated in the lower right, and anorthosite. And it was really the discovery of this anorthosite, which is a rock type made up predominantly of one mineral, calcium-rich feldspar, that really sparked models for the formation of the moon, new models for the formation of the moon and evolution. And that's because anorthosite, made up of this calcium-rich feldspar, while that mineral is not rare on Earth, actually it's one of the main rock-forming minerals, finding it in large abundances and finding anorthosite in large abundances is rare. There needs to be almost a global mechanism for trying to create that much anorthosite if we think that this lighter colored rock type actually makes up the lunar highlands. And so that sparked two teams suggested new models in the 1970s, less than a year after having the samples, new models for how the moon thermally and chemically evolved. And those teams were led by John Wood and John Smith. And so in both models, the moon starts off after accretion, very hot. And you can see that in this lovely Goddard Space Flight Center graphic of what the moon might have looked like while it was still largely molten, but starting to form rocks on the surface. And so both of the initial models from the 1970s start off with a moon that is mostly magma. It's a magma ocean, or we call it the lunar magma ocean model for the evolution of the moon. And the depth to which this magma ocean existed, whether it was whole moon as you see depicted in the cartoon or molten to some depth, that's still debated. But we'll just proceed with this cartoon image that's shown here. So the moon starts off mostly molten, but then it starts to cool down. And as it cools, minerals start to crystallize out. And we think that magnesium-rich minerals like olivine and pyroxene would have been the first to form. They would have been more dense than the liquid from which they were crystallizing, and so they would have fallen or sunk to the bottom of the magma ocean and crystallized upwards and built upwards through the mantle over time. At some point though, about 80% solidification of the magma ocean, the liquid has changed composition and also has changed temperature. And so at that point, you start to crystallize like new minerals. And that's when anorthite comes into play. Anorthite will crystallize, but it'll be less dense than the melt from which it's crystallizing from. And so being less dense, it will want to float. And so anorthite, we think, would have floated in this magma ocean liquid that was left, and actually formed the crust or skin of the moon. And so that's the general model for how we believe the moon would have formed a largely anorthitic crust or anorthositic crust. And so getting Apollo 11 samples to Earth and into the laboratory where they could be analyzed and studied by geologists really changed the way we view the moon as fundamentally and as early as 1970. And this model, the lunar magma ocean model, is still widely used today. There are different variants on it, and we understand it a lot more through experimental geology and doing experimental petrology in the lab. But as I said before, these are very early models, are still the basis on which we still understand how the moon thermally and chemically evolved. Now, the next science case study that I want to look at is Apollo 17. And there are a few interesting things. There are many things, but few I want to focus on about Apollo 17. Now, Apollo 17, of course, landed in 1972 in the Taurus Littoral Valley on the eastern rim of Mare Serenitatis that you can see here. And here, like we had before, you can just see the difference between what happened in Apollo 11, as indicated by the yellow circle around the Intrepid. Remember, the footprint of the Apollo 11 astronauts is actually much smaller than what's indicated by that oval. And in comparison, you see in the orange tracks, the traverses that the Apollo 17 astronauts, Eugene Cernan and Jack Schmidt took. You can see they did three EVAs, and they were really able to travel that long because of two reasons. One, they had a lot longer on the lunar surface. So in comparison to Apollo 11, that only had 2.5 hours to explore, the Apollo 17 astronauts had about 75 hours to explore. They were able to travel much further because they had a lunar roving vehicle, an LRV. And so they were actually not only able to travel longer distances, but actually bring more material back because they had a way of bringing them back. During that time, they collected around 111 kilograms of material. And so you'll remember back to the beginning that the total Apollo program brought back 382 kilograms. And so Apollo 17 was really the a really heavy player in bringing back a lot of material. Okay, so and similar to what we saw for Apollo 11, here you see a Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter camera image with the traverses the astronauts took and crater names and pit stops located on the shown overlaying on the image. Now, the point I want to make here as well is that one major advantage to sample return with crew is that we get geologic context to the samples collected. And actually, Apollo 17 was the only mission to have a fully fledged geologist on board. And so having someone who can critically evaluate the samples that can be collected, noticing new opportunities for sampling, noticing, you know, humans notice things that are a little out of the ordinary, having those instincts and those opportunities really made a big difference on Apollo 17 and with the Apollo program in general. Highlighted the value of having humans on the surface of another planet. Okay, so what I want to focus on here is one particular station on Apollo 17, and that's Apollo Station 6. And so here you see a high resolution narrow angle camera image of a boulder complex at that Station 6 location. And you can see that we have, even with these high resolution images, we can see a boulder trail. So this boulder that you see in the middle rolled down this slope until where it's located today. And the Apollo 17 astronauts sampled that boulder complex. And you can see that illustrated by the cartoon on the same slide. All of the numbers beginning with a 7 indicate Apollo 17 samples. That's the nomenclature used for Apollo 17 materials. And this just beautifully highlights that we know exactly where these samples were taken, and that highlights the significance of actually being able to go somewhere and collect a sample with known geologic context. Some of the rocks shown in this cartoon have not only helped us understand the chemistry of the lunar highlands, the lunar crust, and lunar magmatism in general, but some of those rocks have been dated to more than 4.2 billion years old. And so they also allow us to constrain the age of the lunar crust, and by extension, the duration of the lunar magma ocean. And so they really have been very critical in helping us address and understand how the moon formed and evolved. Another interesting find of the Apollo 17 mission was the discovery of sample 74220. Which is an unusual soil sample that was discovered at Shorty Crater, indicated by the picture on the left-hand side of your screen. The sample is part of a volcanic eruption on the moon that formed a pyroclastic deposit that you can see here. And we think that this deposit and these samples were about 3.5 billion years old, so also very old compared to, you know, things that we have easy access to on Earth. Most of the sample consists of orange glass spherules. You can see those indicated here. And these are basically small lava droplets that didn't have time to form minerals before they cooled. And so on the right-hand side of the screen is how we think these formed. So we have a volcanic eruption from a vent. We have these lava droplets spewed out. And because the moon didn't have an atmosphere, they essentially quenched in that vacuum and then fell back to Earth as these glass spherules that have now been sampled. An important legacy of the Apollo era studies of lunar samples was that the moon really lacked, and all the lunar samples lacked, hydrated minerals. It was very hard to find lunar water in any of the samples that were brought back using the technologies available at the time. And also orbital missions up until the mid to late 2000s hadn't been able to detect definitively any water on the surface of the moon. That was until the mid to late 2000s, when a series of missions, including the one that I'm showing an image of here, Moon Mineralogy Mapper, a NASA instrument that flew on the Indian Space Agency's Chandrayaan 1 mission, found hydroxyl and water all over the lunar surface, but particularly at the lunar poles, as you can see in this figure. And so concurrently, and thanks to advancements in laboratory mass spectrometers, at around the same time, water was also found in lunar samples for the first time. Definitively, we could say this was lunar water and not terrestrial contamination. In 2011, water was also found, detected in tiny micrometer-sized melt inclusions trapped in olivine crystals within those same orange glass beads. And these results suggest that parts of the lunar interior might be as wet as some portions of Earth's mantle. So complete 180 degree turn on what we thought during the Apollo era, that the moon was bone dry. Now we know actually there is lunar water both in the interior and on the surface. And together, these types of studies have really sparked a revolution in lunar volatiles research, both looking at lunar magmatic volatiles, those in the interior, and those on the surface. And how can we use those volatiles and those water-rich ices on the surface as resources for future exploration? Last year, a new initiative was released to study unopened lunar Apollo samples. Those are samples that have been returned to Earth with the other Apollo samples, and they were either photographed really quickly or there was minimal analysis done on them, but then they were specially curated, specially stored under different conditions for future generations. And so many of those samples have not been studied or looked at or even opened for 50 years, and some haven't even been opened since they were collected on the lunar surface. Since we're now in the future, we're in 2020, NASA decided to release some of these previously unopened samples through the Apollo Next Generation Sample Analysis Program. And so one of the samples is shown here on the top slide, and this is an X-ray scan of Apollo 17 sample 73002. It was collected on the Apollo 17 mission and is part of a double drive tube or a core sample. So this is one of two samples. Before it was locked away, it was X-ray scanned, and that's what you see on the top panel. The image is a bit blurry, but even from that image taken in the 1970s, you can see some detail. You can see there's sample in there. That's a good start. You can also see that the colors are different. So brighter material will be more dense material, more dense minerals, and then less dense material will appear darker. So we can tell that there's some heterogeneity, some different lithologies in there. But then it was locked away for 47 years until last year when it was scanned again using new technologies. And you can just see the difference here. It's higher resolution, the image. We start to pull out things that are very small micrometer size objects. We start to see bigger differences within class that previously had looked like they might all be one material. Now we see there are differences. And so after it was scanned using a new generation micro X-ray computed tomography scanner, the sample was opened. And here you see the wonderful curators at NASA's Johnson Space Center having just taken the sample out of its container and put it onto the processing bench. And you can see the beautiful sample laid out here. And so this photograph is taken before they started dissecting and subsampling the core to then give it to the science team. Now, this initiative is being run like a modern day sample return mission, a big Apollo style sample return mission. The team consists of over 50 researchers from across the world, and it links together several generations of lunar scientists of very early career and then Apollo era scientists as well. It presents an opportunity for us to learn new things about the history of the moon, from a sample that has never been studied before, from a geologically very interesting region of the lunar surface. And it also allows us a really good opportunity to understand what worked and what didn't work with Apollo sample curation in order for us to better prepare for samples that might come back from Artemis and other sample return missions. Now you're probably asking yourself, well, why are we talking about going back to the surface of the moon to collect more sample? Is future sample return really needed? And the easy answer is yes. We have a lot of information. We've learned a lot from the Apollo lunar samples and also lunar meteorites, but we don't have true diversity. Most of our samples come from this geologically restricted area on the lunar near side. And we know from orbit probes that have gone to the surface on the far side that there's a lot to be learned from moving outside of this near side region of the moon. So far in the collection, we don't have any pieces of the lunar mantle, which would be crucial to helping us pin down its thermochemical evolution. We don't have any samples definitively from the lunar far side that we probably have in meteorite samples, but we don't have the geologic context that goes with those. And so going to the far side is really important. One of the largest, if not the largest, impact basin in the inner solar system, certainly on the moon, is South Pole Aitken Basin, outlined here in the black dashed line. And you can, it's at the lunar South Pole, and it had the potential to expose mantle rocks at the surface. Also, dating such an ancient and old basin would be really important for constraining lunar crater counting and also extending that to other planetary surfaces. Importantly, we now know that there are lunar polar volatiles. And so we need to be able to go and sample those and understand, are they really a resource that we can use for future exploration, not only of the moon, but of the solar system. And also to just understand how they formed and evolved and how what their character is, what their composition is. So we still have a lot to learn about the lunar surface, and I've just gone through a couple of examples, but we really need more samples to better constrain how the moon formed, and that will in turn help us to inform us about how the Earth formed as well and what was impacting the Earth-Moon system over time. We see the action of plate tectonics on Earth, and it's really erased the very earliest record we have of what was happening on Earth in the Hadean and very early on. But that record is preserved on the moon. And so the moon really is a touchstone for understanding early solar system processes. So we still have a lot to learn from lunar samples and lunar sample return. The future really is lunar exploration. I just mentioned lunar polar volatiles, and these are really, the poles are very geologically interesting. And we now have several programs that are targeting the lunar south pole to go and look for water ice. You can see ice exposures indicated on this south pole projection of the lunar surface. Several missions have been proposed to go very soon to the lunar south pole to characterize those volatile elements and to see what their lateral distribution is like, how they change with depth, what their chemistry is. Do we only find them in permanent shadowed regions of craters, or are they all on the lunar, all across the lunar surface? And so two missions that I'll just focus on really quickly are the European Space Agency's Prospect package, which is a package for resource observation and in-situ prospecting for exploration, commercial exploitation and transportation prospect. And it will operate on the lunar surface of the moon as part of a Russian mission, Luna 27, and that's slated to go to the moon in 2022 and visit the lunar south pole. In parallel, NASA has announced, as early as this week, they announced their new lunar exploration plan that includes VIPER, which stands for Volatiles Investigating Polar Exploration Rover, VIPER. And it's a mobile robot that will go to the south pole of the moon. And again, characterize the volatiles that are there and give us an idea of, it's kind of like a scout or a prospecting mission, go out and see what's there for us to determine whether it's useful to go and further explore those volatiles and then potentially use those as a resource. And so VIPER is planned for delivery to the lunar surface in, I believe, 2023. And then, of course, the Artemis program at the moment concludes with Artemis 3, which will see humans on the surface of the moon again at the lunar south pole, potentially, in 2024. And part of that mission will be to collect samples, as you see in this beautiful NASA illustration here. collecting samples from the surface of the moon, as I say, in 2024. And so there's a lot of exciting lunar exploration that's planned, and we really need samples to be either analyzed on the surface by robots to give us an indication of what's there, but really we want lunar samples to be brought back from a different area of the moon so that we can test and refine our models and build new hypotheses about how the moon formed and evolved. So thank you very much for joining me tonight. And with that, I will take any questions. Thank you.
Okay, can you hear me now? Okay. So the first question is, how is water stored in the samples?
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good. I've been having a lot of audio issues today, as you know.
Us too.
It comes with the territory, right? Being in this internet age and doing everything remotely. Anyway, that's a great question. How are volatiles stored in the samples? And so actually most of my work has been looking for and searching for water in these, mostly in lunar rock samples, although now I'm moving into looking at some lunar soils myself. And in the lunar samples, I mentioned that in the Apollo era, they didn't find hydrated minerals. What we would think of as, you know, terrestrial geologists on Earth, when we look at rocks, things like amphiboles and biotites. None of those minerals that contain lots and lots of hydroxyl OH locked up into their crystal structure were found in the lunar materials. And it wasn't until the late 2008, 2009 that people started to realize that actually lunar samples and the majority of lunar samples do contain a mineral that has hydroxyl in it. It just contains very small abundances. And so you need specialized equipment like special electron microbeam techniques and ion probe techniques to actually detect that water. And so that's what a lot of my work has been doing, is looking at a mineral that we're actually all very familiar with. You may not know it yet, but the mineral apatite, it's a calcium phosphate mineral that actually makes up our teeth and our bones. And so it's not dry on Earth. It's not dry in our bodies, it contains water. And just like that in lunar samples and in meteorites, we find this mineral apatite, and it contains very tiny amounts of this hydroxyl. And so with that, we can then probe the water content of lunar rocks, working backwards, lunar lavas, magmas, and then try and say something about the interior of the moon and what those source regions that those volcanic eruptions came from, how much water did they contain? Not just water, but also things like carbon and fluorine and chlorine. But it's different for lunar soils. So in samples that we might get from the poles, we're looking at soil samples. And if they have ices, those ices will probably be adhered to on the surfaces of grains. And they may be locked up in impact melts, tiny impact melts that form when we have space weathering of lunar soil. So that really we don't know yet what the soil samples from the poles will contain, because we've never been able to preserve those kind of samples and bring them back. We've not done that type of sample return mission where we bring back soils that contain those ices. And so that'll be really cool to see what those samples look like if we bring them back with Artemis.
And a little more specific on the formation of these at the poles. Can you speak to that? Multiple formation processes, perhaps?
Perhaps, yes. So the impact of space weathering. So the moon is, excuse me, the moon, as I said, doesn't have a very thick atmosphere like Earth does. It has a very thin atmosphere, almost no atmosphere, if you like. And so the moon is exposed to the harsh environment of space. And so it gets bombarded with galactic cosmic rays and solar wind. And so it's likely that those interactions on the surface create hydrogen, liberate molecules to then hop around on the surface. Essentially, we see these artist conceptions, or what people think is happening on the surface, of hydrogen hydrogen moving around the surface until they find these areas of permanent shadow where they can basically be stored and build up and accumulate over time. And so it's likely that there are multiple sources. Those are from space weathering, the ones that I just described. But of course, the moon has been subjected to impacts for its entire history, from asteroids and comets and micrometeorites. And so those materials for sure added volatile rich elements to the surface that then would have accumulated perhaps in some of these areas. We also, when we have volcanic eruptions, have had volcanic eruptions in the past, those would have liberated volatile rich elements. And so if you've ever seen pictures of some of the very highly vesicular Apollo basalts, like 15555 or 15016, they're full of what look like holes. And they are really testaments to the volatile rich nature of some types of lunar volcanic rocks and magmas. And so it's likely that all of those volatiles would have been periodically ejected into near lunar space. And so condensation of that would also lead to another potential source of lunar volatiles. And so it's going to be really interesting to see what the lunar polar regions, what analyses in situ on the surface from example Prospect and the mission, the instrument on board Prospect is called PROSPA, and it's designed to look at the speciation of volatile chemistry in those polar ices. See what that tells us about whether we can differentiate all those sources that I just talked about, whether we can actually differentiate those to understand what is the relative contribution of those different potential sources, the interplay between them. And does it vary across the lunar surface? If we visit multiple places in the next 5 to 10 years, what kind of story do we build up? And can that help us account for whether we have a dominant process or whether there's just kind of a heterogeneous mixture of all these different things that have happened?
Okay, this is a good follow-up. As a sample scientist, where would you go?
Oh, I knew that question was going to come. And I would personally... the South Pole, and really anywhere in the South Polar region. There's been some really interesting work coming out of the U2 rover, that Chang'e 4 mission landed on the surface, suggesting that in parts of South Pole Aitken Basin, we might have lunar mantle exposed at the surface. And so not only where would I go, but where would I want to go? Like if I was an astronaut, where would I go? I would go there because I want to see those outcrops. I want to go and sample those outcrops, because that's observing mantle and sampling it will tell us so much about whether our models for lunar thermochemical evolution are right. It'll really constrain the density of the mantle and constrain crustal thickness models, constrain seismology, constrain so much about the moon as a whole. But that's not the only thing you can do in the South Polar region. You can do, as we've talked about, lunar volatiles. If you pick up a sample of South Pole Aitken Basin impact melt, you're also dating the oldest, biggest basin on the moon. It's 2,500 kilometers wide or in diameter. And so you're really pinpointing the earliest basin that we have a record of. And that will really help refine crater counting models and And those models, while they're anchored on the moon, they're applied to all the bodies in our solar system and extrapolated. And so if we can really refine those models and those calculations, then we better understand how old the surfaces elsewhere are. So that's a long-winded way of saying, I agree with where everyone is targeting. I want to go to the South Pole.
Makes sense, especially because finally probing something we know is old.
Yeah.
Seems critical. Yeah.
Exactly.
Geologic record.
Yep.
Another question about the ash or the vitric lava, the orange.
Mm-hmm.
But perhaps we'll come back to that when we actually look through the telescope. I want to bring them online. So let's actually go ahead and do that. I'm going to turn on Mount Lemmon, and then we'll keep Jess for questions.
Hi.
Hi.
No, we're not. Awesome. Yeah. As you can
see, welcome.
So we've been staring at Jupiter for a while, and this hasn't improved too much, but you can see that the shadow has actually made it a good chunk of Jupiter across, and then right here is the red spot. When I spoke earlier, I was incorrect. It was coming from the other side, because of course it is, because everything's rotating counterclockwise. So
this is a nice picture, because if we increase the exposure, you can actually see the moon and its shadow. So here.
Oh, very nice.
Right. There's the moon.
There it is. See the moon, Jupiter, and its shadow and the red. So it would be a perfect picture if only the seeing was much, much better than this.
Yeah, a little unstable. Okay, well, I'm glad that we're watching that transit and a little bit of that Jupiter detail kind of shining through. Let's go to the Apollo 11 or 17 sites while we answer some more of these Dr. Barnes questions, and then we'll probably, depending on time, we might have a few minutes to come back to Jupiter or Saturn for those viewers who maybe didn't see it earlier. But let's go ahead and head back, and then I'll ask the question while you're moving the scope here. So yeah, there's a question about this orange lava droplets, but we'll come back to that. I want to do, maybe we do that when we're actually looking at the site. So this person joined a little late. They weren't sure if it was covered, but I think it's still a good, really good question. How do scientists explain how an entire celestial body can become molten rock if originally accreted from a small, cold dust grain? It seems that later bombardment events would only affect the surface.
Yep, I can answer that for sure. And so in multiple ways. So the chemistry of the rocks that we have back, and the textures, the mineralogy, the isotopic compositions of all the lunar rocks that we've studied, all point to having to have been formed from magma. So like if you were to go and pick up a volcanic rock at Hawaii, you know, okay, you're standing on a volcano, but the chemist, if you took that back to your laboratory, you would be able to say that rock had at some point been molten and then through cooling formed the volcanic textures that you see. And so we don't find, well, actually we do, I'll come back to that in a second. So lunar rocks, really are not like what we expect from undifferentiated carbonaceous chondrite, like for example, or ordinary chondrite materials. They're very different. And so by comparing lunar samples to other samples and comparing them to, for example, the chondritic meteorites, which we know didn't melt, undergo vast melting, we learn a lot about how the moon thermally and chemically evolved. Interestingly, when I mentioned before, you may have seen it, I talked a little bit about exogenous material being encoded in some lunar rocks. We actually have preserved in some lunar breccias pieces of asteroids that impacted the lunar surface through time. So we find pieces of carbonaceous chondrites, for example, inside lunar breccias. And because those lunar breccias have not been heated sufficiently, that carbonaceous chondrite-rich material, which is not lunar, is preserved. Did that answer the question? I kind of ventured off a little bit.
I think so. It's a multifaceted problem.
It is.
So now that we're looking here at the Apollo, I think we're at the Apollo 11 site.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
You presented about these orange spherules, these lava droplets, and we've also seen literature that they're this, and maybe it's two separate actual, you know, components here, but we've heard it as orange ash. So are they droplets or are they ash, or is the terminology just depending on which scientist
mm-hmm.
talking about it?
Yep. So we call them pyroclastic beads or pyroclastic deposits, which on Earth you would think more of being like an ash deposit. But as you see, and I did what I showed the orange glass beads from Apollo 17, the image I showed was kind of a slice through of those glass beads. If you saw them, if I'd shown a different image, you would see that they really are little balls, little spherules. And so it's just a terminology difference between sort of traditional terrestrial geology and kind of Apollo or moon geology. But we mean the same thing, right? We're talking about material spewed from a volcano that then is emplaced in the surrounding area.
Uh-huh. Okay. Another question here. Oops. Pull that back up. Okay. Let's see. Oh, and this seems like maybe a little bit of a follow-up to the water on the moon. Mm-hmm. Wouldn't water on the moon be contaminated from radiation or other things that our atmosphere filters out? I know you talked about the solar wind, mm-hmm. but how much, do we actually worry about volatiles from Earth escaping and maybe being in place on the moon?
In terms of sample return, I think what we're more worried about is we obviously bring the samples back to Earth. And so water's everywhere on Earth. And so we have to do our utmost to make sure that the samples we bring back are not contaminated by sort of a lack of care. And, you know, what we're measuring is actually lunar and not terrestrial water. And I think the discovery of bona fide lunar water inside lunar glass beads in 2008 heralds what has been a very successful curation of the Apollo samples. They are extremely well curated. I've explained this in some classes, like the security measures that the Apollo curators go through to keep these samples safe and the stringent processing that goes on. You know, these samples come into contact with three materials: aluminium, Teflon, and stainless steel. And they're not ever handled directly by people. They're always handled through several layers of gloves, in stainless steel cabinets with nitrogen gas. And so it's just a testament to how well they've been preserved. And so in saying that, like, part of the ANCSA program is actually to test and see, well, could we do things even better when looking towards Artemis than we've done for Apollo? Are there any things that we can actually refine? And so one thing that some of us on the team will be looking at is, are there ways that we can even better preserve that water signature in the samples that come back in the future? So that's a great question. But I think we're more worried about, you know, when we bring the samples back than about, you know, atmosphere from the Earth escaping to the moon. It's an interesting thing to think about, but I think, yeah, we're more worried about what we might do to them, because that's going to affect the story that we can tell from those rocks.
Yes. Yes. Lots of precautions have
Indeed.
To be in place. And I know there's different levels of labs versus, I guess the density of how dirty it is in there, like parts per million, parts per billion type of clean labs. I think you've probably worked in mm-hmm. A suite of levels.
Yep.
Is that kind of how they work?
Yes, so I mean, to go, if you are fortunate to go into the labs themselves where the sample processors actually are manipulating samples in these glove boxes and actually subsampling for science teams, you know, you have to go in a full bunny suit. I forget what class level those labs are. It might be class 1000 or class 100, very, very clean labs. And so, yeah, no, you know, contamination free. They do their utmost to keep these samples super clean so that we can really go down to the part per billion, part per million level and see water at those concentrations. If we hadn't have done that, if, you know, the Apollo era scientists had not thought through properly how to take care of these samples, we may not know that there's lunar water definitively in lunar samples. We may still not know that. As one example, there are many examples of things we may not know geochemically if they hadn't done such a good job. And so I always applaud the Apollo curators through their diligence with these samples.
Yes. Yes. And this is a question that's kind of a big forward thought is, how will water be processed or harvested from the moon for propulsion for interplanetary travel? I guess a hydrogen type of extraction fuel.
Exactly. Well, depending what, so we think there's water ice at the poles. And so extracting or separating hydrogen and oxygen and then using those as fuels, potentially with, you know, burning some types of lunar soil grains in there too, to kind of extract that hydrogen and oxygen. But yeah, those are the main ingredients that will be used as propulsion fuel. You said it quite right. And the whole problem with, as I'm sure everyone's aware, we use a lot of fuel just to get out of Earth's gravity. And so having a fuel source on the moon is kind of like a petrol station, or what do you say over here, gas station, for going elsewhere in the solar system. And it really is our stepping stone to, if we want to ever go to Mars. I'm definitely in the camp, you know, use the moon, but don't abuse the moon, because we've learned so much about the moon that we wouldn't want to do anything to harm it or to harm the integrity of the science we can learn from samples or remote sensing or from robots roving the surface. We've visited so little of the moon that there's really so much out there to discover. I mean, you just think, and a nice analogy is, we're still discovering things about Earth. We're still visiting uninhabited places and learning new things, visiting the depths of the oceans. You know, just think about how much we don't know about the moon. We've hardly gone anywhere.
Right. Yeah, we barely touched the surface. Exactly. So speaking of the surface, we do have another question, but I want to maybe, before we switch to the Apollo 17, do you want to talk a little bit about the materials that we're seeing here? I mean, we're seeing something very dark, very bright, before we leave the Apollo 11 site, and then we'll answer the next question over at the 17 site.
For sure, yeah. So what we're seeing here are the darker areas are the maria or the volcanic regions. The lighter areas are bits of the highlands crust. And then I think what you're seeing there, I'm not sure which crater it is, but it's so bright that it has to be a crater, a young crater with rays. And so when you see a feature like that, or, you know, more visible on kind of global maps is Tycho, which is down further south. These younger craters look brighter, and sometimes you can even see their rays from like Copernicus or Tycho. And we know they're young because they still have their crater rays present. And so the rays are ejected material from the impact that created that crater. And they haven't been around long enough to have weathered away and become darker. And so we're definitely seeing there some crater ejecta in those brighter areas. But it's useful to remember that the entire lunar surface is covered in regolith. So, you know, the surface is continuously churned up either by large impacts that create the basins and the craters and then eject their material kind of all over the place. But also through micrometeorite bombardment and space weathering, we just get this continual movement of material across the surface. And so if you were to go there, you wouldn't just land on a you'd be very lucky to just land on a lava flow, but you're probably not going to in those big basins. You're going to be sampling soils and regolith material, like was sampled, for example, in Apollo 11.
Ah, okay. So the bright red craters is a good rule of, it's a young feature, I guess, when we kind of...
Young feature, relatively okay. Young crater.
Relatively, yeah. Relatively, so yes.
So that's a nice view, actually, because you can see some of those crater rays on the bottom right. Yeah, if you move down a little bit, you can see some of those. They're elongate linear features that traverse the moon. So interestingly, several of Tycho's crater rays actually pass through some portions of South Pole Aitken Basin. So if we could sample some of that, that would help constrain the age of Tycho as well.
Mm, more reasons to go to the South Pole.
More reasons. I just keep giving you more reasons we need to go.
Yes, let's keep that force going. You know, you got to put it out there. Okay, so we can, this is a really great view of the moon. It's almost nice just staring at it. But let's also take a look at the 17 site. In the last few minutes here. And this was a little bit of a question or follow-up from a little bit ago. So the question about the later bombardment versus accreting grains on the surface is, could that be explained by multiple surface layers being progressively bombarded while lower layers began to cool off like an onion?
Is this the question from Dave?
Yes.
Let me follow just read up. It real quick.
Yes, sometimes reading. Yeah, you might want to read this first. So, yeah, wondering about molten rock, if it's originally accreted this small from small dust grains. It seems like the bombardment.
Oh, I know what it's. Oh, I see what the issue here is. So we think the moon formed from a highly energetic impact event. So we think the Earth, the proto-Earth, before Earth as we know it, we think the proto-Earth was struck by another object, potentially a Mars-sized object traveling quite fast. And that impact, the giant impact, would have flung material out of Earth orbit, and then that material would have re-accreted in Earth orbit to form the moon. And so that's the most popular hypothesis for how the moon formed. But if you're kind of catastrophically destroying or ripping apart pieces of the Earth and the body that came in to crash with it, and then re-accreting another object, obviously the moon started very, very hot. And so that's the one of the reasons why I say the moon, it's achondritic. It was never made cold. It was made hot. And so that's why we have the lunar magma ocean model. You know, starting very hot, we would have had to cool. And that's why we do have kind of an onion shape or an onion style layering inside the interior of the moon through the magma ocean model. And so I didn't explain, but that model has some quirks to it. After you completely solidify, you then start moving things around because of density differences within the mantle. But you're quite right too, in that once we have the moon more or less solidified, then we do have other things that are happening. And that's why I said the moon is a treasure trove, because it's been continually bombarded for its lifetime. Poor moon has been battered to pieces all across its surface. You can see that here. And we have big basins. We've got South Pole Aitken Basin, which is massive, but it's filled itself with other basins, craters. And even when we pick up lunar samples, some of them we can see tiny micrometeorite craters on the surface. So there is cratering at all scales, and that's indicative of different types of material hitting the surface over time and churning material up continuously almost.
Okay. And speaking of treasure troves, we've got another question. Are there any current plans to investigate the lunar caves, which I understand to be treasure troves?
Treasure troves, yes. So for many reasons, we want to find, a cliff or, like you say, a lava tube or even a crater and kind of scale it to get an idea of the stratigraphy of the lunar crust and the lunar the lunar surface as we go with depth. And there have been several kind of pilot or mission concept studies that have been proposed to go to lava tubes. But I don't think there's any current plan that has funding to go and actually do that. But it would be super interesting, to see layering, to see what the stratigraphy is like, to do magnetism studies on those types of layering, to sample them and get the geochemistry. It would be super informative. But no plans right now. But that's a great question.
Okay. Yes, I know we have a lot of lava tubes in northern Arizona, near the Flagstaff area. And do you know of any analog mapping, or is it too... I don't know. Are the northern Arizona lava tubes a good analog?
That's a great question, and I honestly I'm not sure.
It's a question for the Astrogeology Center up in Flagstaff.
Exactly. Yeah, and maybe also the people who do the astronaut training, because I mentioned before we only had one Apollo astronaut, Jack Schmidt, who was actually a geologist. In reality, all of the Apollo astronauts received. Basically, it's often said they received like a master's degree in geology before they went, so they could at least identify different types of rock and pick them up. But now all of the astronauts that are currently being trained, the current schools of astronauts, all get extensive geology training. They all go out in the field to different areas, most of them in Arizona, to look at different types of environments that they might encounter on future exploration activities with crew. So super exciting. Great question. I'm not sure the answer.
Yeah. Yes. And so thinking about that same idea that they were trained to pick up these different types of rocks, but then bringing it back down to Earth, have you noticed any stark differences in the chemistry between, say, the S11 and the S17 sites, or are they essentially within the same sort of relative chemistry?
So that's a really interesting question. Actually, the two that we focused on, Apollo 11 and 17, there are very big differences. I mentioned before that Apollo 17 collected a lot more samples than Apollo 11. They could travel further. They could sample very interesting boulders, the size of houses, that kind of thing. Whereas they didn't do so much of that on Apollo 11. So Apollo 17 like basalts and Apollo 11 basalts are very similar in their chemistry. They're both high titanium mare basalts, which contain a lot of the mineral ilmenite. But Apollo 17 also sampled some of those highland samples from the boulders that I showed from that boulder cluster. And they're very different. They are pieces of rocks that we think cooled very slowly in the moon's crust and were later exposed. And so they tell us different things, but generally in terms of volcanic rocks, they're quite similar. If I would have talked a little bit more about the other Apollo missions, Apollo 12 and 15, for example, give us low titanium mare basalts as kind of the major basalt group that they sampled. And so they're different chemistry. They have less of that ilmenite in them. So that's a really good question about the chemistry. Yeah.
Okay. Yes, we need more sites. I mean, they're you know, relatively close on the moon, I think, right? Overall.
Yeah.
Maybe do you want to go back to the big view of the moon and then just kind of with the cursor, Travis or Alessandro, and just kind of highlight where we were looking? I mean, it's really nice with the zoomed in view, but maybe let's get an idea of that spread of think about, okay, they were different chemistries, but in the grand scheme of the whole surface area of the moon, they're not too far off.
So right now we are pointing now at Apollo 17, and then Apollo 11 is, well, you can point it up. Yeah, right there.
Okay. Oh, that's right. And you can see that bright feature. Was that the same bright? Oh, maybe that's a different one, but okay. Yes. Well, all right, that wraps up our questions. I'll just double check and make sure any other ones aren't coming through on the chat. I know I've got a question for the recording of today's program. We are going to upload that to our YouTube channel. So I can drop the link before we shut the Zoom down, but all of this will be on our YouTube. So you can check that out for that question, and I'll drop that link in. And we can kind of the last segment of the night is going to come on here in a moment, and I feel like we could mill around on the moon a little bit more. I almost feel as though we should go back to the Terminator, because I know we had different folk probably online when we looked at the Terminator earlier, and then we can let Dr. Barnes go, unless, of course, she can stick around and enjoy the Terminator with us as well. But thank you, Dr. Barnes, for coming on and answering our moon chemistry questions, our lava tube, treasure troves, other treasure troves on the moon, and we thank you.
Thank you so much for the opportunity, and thanks for sticking with it tonight. This has been really fun. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. So yeah, let's go back.
If you can kind of get it centered, and then normally, you know, the moon's super bright, so if you overexpose, you just don't really get much. But what we should be able to do is, if we do overexpose the moon, go ahead, and we keep going, go all the way up, and maybe make the exposure a little bit longer. Oh, maybe not. Well,
there
you can
go.
See the refraction right there through our telescope. We're trying to show the dark side of the moon, which obviously is where the Terminator starts, but the moon's a little too bright, a little too full for us to catch Earth shine there.
Yes. Yes, Earth shine, of course, is that reflected light from Earth that then strikes the moon. So when you see the moon in a crescent phase, it's a little more obvious. You see the crescent, but you see the sort of rest of the moon, and that's this Earth shine. And yeah, once we get past half full, it's just a lot of light for it to, overpower that Earth shine. But you know what? This was a feature I was really hoping was still popping out. So if you overexpose again and then go to that, I think you're already probably going there. I forget the name of that mountain or that crater edge that's popping up. More in the northern.
Kind of right.
Yeah, can we zoom in on that? Because I think this is a really great point. So there's only two objects in the night sky that humans have depth perception with. It's because we're looking at little points of light coming from far distances for most objects, especially stars and faint targets. But there's two planetary objects, and of course the moon is one, and Saturn is the other. And they're the only two objects we get depth perception with. And the moon, the reason we see this depth perception is because of this phase that we get to see it in. So this is a great time to talk about how strange the moon is and the type of orbit that it resides in. Like, we kind of refer to the dark side of the moon. And of course, we love that album from Pink Floyd, but it's actually a terrible way to refer to the moon. And that's because all sides of the moon get light. And I think that when we can finally see these Terminator kind of features, this might help kind of drive that idea home. And so you're getting the depth perception because of the shadows cast by those tall, this must be an edge of a crater rim that's been blown out by a big lava flow. So you can kind of see that circular feature. And those crater rim walls are so high that they are starting to get their morning. So if we were standing on that little strip of the wall that's popping up there, that is right there. That's where it's a good morning on the moon right now. And so the light is going to keep illuminating as we get towards our full moon. I think full moon's Thursday, if I remember correctly. And so as we get closer and closer to Thursday, this entire side of the moon that we get to see is going to be entering its full daytime. So it's just, if there was an atmosphere on the moon, that's where the sunrise would be right now. Of course, there's only, depending on who you talk to, an exosphere or no sphere, nothing really. But, there might be some like very thin layer of atmospheric, as Jess kind of talked about with the volatiles and things sort of trapped and the solar wind playing a part. But again, just to drive this home, that's where it's a nice morning time on the moon. It's popping up. It's only going to get more illuminated as the night and day goes on. And we do have a question on how high are those walls. That's a good question. And I had tried to ask Steve Larson about that a little bit earlier, and in the sense of, are these the same scale height of the mountains on Earth? And they're roughly the same scale height. Perhaps if we knew the exact name of that, we could double check the height of that. But essentially, okay. I think the way Steve put it is that there's no Everest, there's no Mount Everest on the moon, but they are similar in you know, at least the type of heights that we see. But yeah, do you know, Travis?
I do not know off the top of my head, but if anybody wants to do the math, you could easily calculate it literally based on this image. You know, take the size of the moon, make a perpendicular line to that of a ray from the sun, and you could see how far off, based on where the actual terminator is, how high that moon or that mountain would have to be in order to still be lit by the sun. And that's kind of what Kuiper was doing with a lot of those images that they were taking for the survey. Yeah. You know, as far as I'm aware, they didn't take a lot of pictures at full moon, because although the whole moon's illuminated, you just get a picture of the surface. While if you're taking images during the terminator, you can actually effectively get topography of the surface without ever actually touching it.
Yeah, so I was adding, so this bay, I can't remember how tall are the walls of this bay, but the bay is called the Sinus Iridum, which is the bay of the rainbow, if I remember correctly. A particularity about the moon is that it has the Alps and the Apennines. And although the Alps on Earth are taller than the Apennines, on the moon is the opposite. So the Apennines are the tallest mountain on the moon, and they are pretty tall. I don't remember how tall they are, but they are comparable to Earth mountains. But consider how big is the moon. So they look more impressive.
Yeah.
Ah, yes. Okay. And talking about measuring it, if we really wanted to put ourselves up, we could almost use the, so we're looking through a camera where these lights, these little bits of light are hitting the detector. And we know the size of the detector, and we know how many pixels that detector has. And we could actually, I would say, measure that shadow. We could go Euclidean, right? We could actually measure the height of that shadow. Let's see, like more, the one that's still in the full sun, or not, it is fully illuminated, the more, I guess, making my directions right, eastern side there. So I can see that, yeah, that guy, right? So if we actually really wanted to paint ourselves, we could brute force, almost measure the shadow and the height of that feature. That one actually is pretty sharp.
When somebody asks a question like that during one of my programs, it's called being nerd sniped, because you've now been asked a question that you really want to answer, but it's definitely not the time to do so because it's going to take a long time to do it. But now I really want to determine the height of that.
I know. Well, I thought of that when Steve was talking, and then of course now one of our attendees has asked. And so, the loose answer is that they're comparable to scale height mountains on Earth, but we don't know the exact. But if we really wanted to nerd out, we could do some measuring of these shadows. Let's see, is there another moon feature, or do we want to hop to... Oh, that person says go for it. Oh, you guys are ready? You guys want to do some shadow measuring? Maybe we should have an Art of Planetary Science, let's do data one night. But let's see. Oh, you know what? This is another area. You can see those kind of wrinkles. And we had a question about the lava tubes. Those look like either flows or tubes to me. I'm no geomorphologist, but that looks like that might be some of those big lava tubes.
Here's some more.
Yeah, is there anything else popping out of the Terminator? And so just to really drive, you know, International Observe the Moon Night home here for our final thoughts is that, again, they kind of choose this phase that's great detail on the edge here. You get that depth perception. As I said, the moon and Saturn are the only two that we get depth perception with. Saturn is because of the equatorial tilt combined with the fact that it has rings. And so we see those rings kind of either like nod up or nod down as Saturn completes its 28 years around the sun. So you got to wait 7 years to kind of see different Saturn seasons. But of course, with the moon, we get that every 28 days, we can kind of get this detail. And International Observe the Moon Night also chooses this it works out really well to where the moon is kind of up in the most favorable time of the night for observing. You've probably noticed the moon during the day and in the middle of the night, caught those moon rises at different times of the day. And so this particular phase, I think it rose today something like 2 p.m. maybe, somewhere in the early afternoon. The moon rose to the east, and then we kind of have the moon up all night. And so this is also just a really great time, in addition to getting that depth perception like we don't usually get in space. But it's also just favorable because I'm sure Travis and Alessandro can speak to this too. Late nights of the telescope add up, and your circadian rhythm does start to be affected. So if we can observe at 8 p.m., 9 p.m., we're actually pretty happy astronomers. Let's see, make sure we've got all the questions answered. I think so. Yeah. Other than our attendees saying, go for the CCD measurements. if there's any last questions, you can throw them in now. I feel like the other part of the next is our music set. We're kind of ending the night a little fun now. Hopefully, for those of you signed on, you can just kind of play some of this DJ set that we're going to go into next. But we've got a little squish time here until we actually hit play on that. I feel like I want to look at one more object. You guys are up at the telescope. I guess another neat thing about the past few nights, if folk have looked up out at the sky, is that Mars was very close to the moon, if I recall, a few nights ago. Should we go take a look at Mars? How does that look in the 24-inch?
Well, it's going to be smaller than Jupiter.
Okay.
But is up in the sky, so, you know, we might as well.
And I know later in the night, way later in the night, Uranus and Neptune are up, and so obviously we won't get to that, but this is where I'm going to plug in. I know we just did our opening weekend, but we actually do have events scheduled for the closing of the art show, and since that's about a month away from now, of course, things are going to be a little bit slightly shifted in the night sky. They're going to rise a little bit earlier, barely, but it'll be a month from now. So essentially at the tail end of the night when we do a telescope session on October 24, we will look at Uranus and Neptune. And I did get the old Uranus question, of course, in the chat room. I will say that. So comical. Yes, but you'll notice my pronunciation of Uranus is to not make children laugh. But anyway, we do have some more telescope viewing sessions essentially scheduled for the Art of Planetary Science. We do have some more music events scheduled or at least one more music for the actual closing night of the show. So just think ahead that we're going to be doing more telescoping and also more musicing about a month from now. But yeah, let's just take a peek at Mars. Can't hurt. We'll actually be talking about Mars a little bit tomorrow. Tomorrow we're kind of focusing on the sun and stars in the early part of the day. But I do want to take some time to talk about Mars tomorrow because we're ending our art show with a Mars inspired dance, or rather the moons of Mars. And so since we are International Observe the Moon Night, we can't forget that little Mars here, about 1/6 the size of Earth, is a much smaller planet, but actually has two moons. Or yet again, as we were talking earlier, they're really satellites. They're really these captured asteroids, right? They're stolen from the asteroid belt. And that's Phobos and Deimos. And Phobos and Deimos actually orbit opposite directions. So yet again, kind of alluding to the fact that like, hey, these didn't form naturally around Mars. They were sort of captured in these interesting ways. And so even though it is, you know, much smaller than Jupiter, we're actually seeing a little bit of detail. Again, we're watching our atmosphere dance around above the telescope. But you can actually see that similar to the dark regions of the moon, where we have these dark, big lava flows, you can kind of see some of these dark features on right there in the center. And then I don't know if my eyes are telling me, because I believe it, yes, you're seeing it too, polar caps. And so these are huge deposits of carbon dioxide and also water ice. And so I think that's a big drive for the continued exploration of of Mars and this hope for life is that, well, we know that the poles are actually loaded with ice. And a lot of the erosion that we see on Mars, we think happens from these big catastrophic events where a lot of those poles, those ice cap poles, cascade down towards the equator. You can almost think about when Earth has been covered in ice, that we refer to this time as a snowball Earth time. And so we can think maybe that Mars has gone through these iterations, it's like covered in ice, and those poles are really huge. Again, the cursor, they kind of circled around it. But even for this small planet, you see that brighter white area. And there is both a north polar layer deposits and south polar layer deposits. And the north is the bigger one. And so is this telescope, and maybe this is a good time for you to talk about a little bit about the telescope when we actually look through it. This is flipping it, north is south, south is north. Is that doing that? Or maybe it's just hard to tell which way is north for this one.
If you remember our views of the moon, this is set to show north as up and the correct way, you know, just as if you were looking through a pair of binoculars. So the bottom of this is, so that should be the south pole of Mars.
Okay. Perfect. And yeah, do you maybe want to, I know it's kind of, well, you got a decent view of the telescope, just to maybe kind of point out the different, yeah, the structure. I know that's a big question. I know when I operate telescopes, one of the first questions folk ask is, well, how much is it? So maybe you can kind of go through the specs of like where the light's coming through or pointing the refractor and how much this big guy costs.
So our 24-inch telescope was maybe $250,000 or so. Our nice big 32-inch telescope was about $500,000, but that's just the telescope and the mount. That doesn't include the dome, the electronics, the cameras, and you know the telescope operators. We come pretty much free with the telescope, I think. This is a written design. It is effectively the same as kind of those ones that you have in your backyard that have a big primary mirror on the front or on the back, and then your mirror up at the top. So the light comes down from space, and then right back here is where the primary mirror is. It goes back up towards the top, right here. And then it goes back down through this tube in the middle and out to our camera in the back. That's how a lot of telescopes are designed nowadays. It's the exact same design that, say, the Hubble Space Telescope uses among pretty much every professional telescope in the world right now, though there are some newer that are coming online. Ours uses a truss system. It's actually made out of carbon fiber, and that's not only to make it light, but it also thermally calm. It doesn't thermally expand a whole bunch, so that it doesn't actually increase or decrease the size of the telescope temperature, which means that we can stay in focus for much longer compared to if, you know, the entire thing was a giant tube made out of steel or something. This is, of course, very different than up here, which is a little 5-inch refractor, and this uses lenses. So think of your old Galileo telescope. So we got some lenses up here at the front, then we got a couple more at the back, and then we got actually a couple more back here for a corrector, and then the camera all the way back here. And so you can kind of think of these as really, really big camera lenses. But you know, this one up here, this would be a what is it? Let's see, 660 millimeter f/5 or camera lens. This would be a 4,700 and something millimeter f/8 camera lens. So pretty long photo, but it'd be pretty bad at sports because it's quite slow.
Yes, and so the tracking, you know, wouldn't be able to track, say, Earth-based satellites. Would that be?
With this telescope, it doesn't quite hit the speeds that you would need to something in low Earth orbit. However, our Shulman telescope, it should actually be able to get to the correct speeds to actually follow satellites, though that because that kind of software is really complex and we don't really have a firm grasp on getting that onto our system. But I personally always wanted to track, you know, the International Space Station. So
yes.
I just say that while during one of our programs, I was able to, you know, use a program and find where the ISS was going to go through the sky, and I was able to point the telescope where it was going to be, and or you know, and saw the ISS go whoop right through the field, which was quite cool.
Wow! Yeah, how lucky at the you just happened to be looking through the scope, and then a satellite passes through. Consider yourself lucky in that regard. We do have a question for you. Is this telescope comparable in size to the one Lowell observed to, quote unquote, see the canals? I'm trying to remember the size of the Lowell telescope. They still have the ones that he used, right? Up in Flagstaff.
So Lowell up in Flagstaff, I believe that was a 20 or a 24 inch telescope. Should be comparable. I'm trying to remember though.
Much different focal length. Probably.
Yeah, I think it was a refractor, was it not?
Yes,
I think it's a refractor, but yes, I agree. I was thinking it was around 24 inches as well.
So this would be comparable in size. I would actually say that this telescope is better quality than that one. Not only is it much newer, but because it uses mirrors, it's a much smaller design. You can imagine the size of this is 5 inches and it's this long. This is 24 inches in diameter. Take the same kind of this telescope, if it was a refractor like the low one, it would be what, 20 feet long, 30 feet long? It would be incredibly huge, which also means that the system sags under its own weight because you have a really big piece of glass on one side and big heavy instruments on the other. So what they're able to observe, course, is mostly down to really, really good observing, you know, being able to refine details and stare for really, really, really long times. But also, it would be the equivalent of what we would call lucky imaging. You know, every night the seeing is going to be slightly different. And so, you know, right now, actually, I would say a little bit below average, but on really, really good nights, it is easy to see, you know, that. The polar regions, the darker regions, you can easily spot those out without even, you know, waiting for, you know, a moment of clarity. And that all just comes down to observing, you know, every night like they did up in Flagstaff.
Yes. Yeah, they were up quite well. Lowell really wanted to prove that those were canals as well. So I'm sure he was.
Yes,
he really.
Is that, you know, it's at some point you can see for a fraction of a second, you can see some details. So with the camera, there is a processing technique that takes those images and put them together, and so it gives you a higher quality image. When you do that with the brain, it tries to remember what it saw, but it's biased to kind of draw what you think it was.
Yeah.
So it works, but it doesn't work very well with the brain. So
yeah, our brain actually is pretty impressive when it comes to lucky imaging, which is why, unless you do a lot of post-processing, a view of the say, you know, Jupiter with the human eye is going to be better than if you just take a single picture, simply because our brain is continually doing that post-processing. Now, if you have a really nice camera like we do, and you know how to use some software, you can make an image that is well beyond what we can see just using a bunch of very cool techniques. But for a if you decide to come up to the Sky Center and look through our telescopes, that's why we show people visually with eyepieces, because we're basically better than a camera.
And this is another point where I think binoculars are underrated. You can really see a lot with a good pair of binoculars just in your backyard. Again, just what naturally your eye can see. There are some objects that I actually prefer Andromeda Galaxy in binoculars over a telescope. The optical viewing can really go a long way. And yes, our biases, we want to look for water and canals, and we want to look for human faces, or when I worked for the high-rise Mars mission, we got a call where someone said, hey, those, and it was lava flows, like we talked about the lava tunnels. They called and said, those NASA images that you posted of Mars are revealing sandworms on Mars. And I'm like, maybe they just read Dune or, you know, got through the Dune series. But, you know, this particular person was really convinced that the lava tubes on Mars were sandworm tubes. So, you know, we're biased in our ways. You know, maybe that's a part of the brain kind of filling in the voids. We want something to be there. But I think on that note, yet again, in the hopes that we can come visually and optically observe up at Mount Lemmon SkyCenter in good time, safely. Of course, we don't want to put all of our eyeballs on the same eyepiece nowadays. And so I think eyepieces will probably get a lot more clean, cleaner after this. That was something I always thought, maybe we should always be cleaning eyepieces after we all put our eyeballs up to it, right? So maybe that'll be another thing that comes out of COVID. But Alessandro and Travis, thank you so much. Thank you for showing off the moon, Jupiter, Saturn, and throw Mars. I know Mars wasn't in our plan when we originally scheduled you guys. So I really appreciate it. And hopefully we can do this again, whether it's virtually or in person here and still piping you guys in virtually for the 2021 show. We hope SkyCenter comes online again.
And one last thing. I got some follow-up details. Although we still don't know when we're going to be opening up here for our public programs, we do have a science shop down in Tucson on and Bear Canyon, actually kind of pretty much at the base of Mount Lemmon, that we have just opened in the last week or two. So if you buy and, you know, see one of our lovely faces, or, you know, buy some astrophotography prints that we have taken up here using these telescopes, then yeah, you can see that I'm moving the telescope.
Yeah.
By all means, please come by, and we'd love to host you.
Yes, yes. And so for those of you who turned in Friday, we had Adam Block. His astrophotography is done up there at SkyCenter. I'm sure some of his prints are probably there for sale. There is a serious amount of like cool space stuff to go by there. So yeah, some help support. I made this plug yesterday after Adam's talk, is that the way my director put it to me is that the College of Science is broke. And of course they don't have money for these outreach endeavors, but there's Flandreau Science Center, which we were online tonight with for Desert Moon. There's Biosphere 2. I'm sure many Tucsonans have been out to Biosphere 2. There's Mount Lemmon Sky Center. Tumamoc Hill is also under that same sphere of the College of Science outreach components, but not necessarily the funding to do it. So go buy cool space stuff if you can at the Mount Lemmon. It's a new down, I keep calling it downtown just because it's not on a mountain, but it's just at the base of the mountain at that Catalina highway turn off. So yeah, thanks for letting us know. And what's that?
It's downstairs, as my friend would say. You know, the mountain is upstairs, Tucson's downstairs.
Okay, that makes more sense. That Kitt Peak campus was downtown. So yeah, you just, what mountain you're on is you know, relative to whatever you call everything else. yes. All right. Well, thank you guys. I'll go ahead and switch over to the next, the last operation of the night, and thank you again.
Okay. You're very welcome. Thank you for having us.
Bye.
Bye.
All right. We've made it to the last segment of the night. I'm glad that we've, had such a fun day. This is like, the next is just an extra fun bit that we've prepared for you. We've got, I've got a co-host that I'm about to bring online who's going to then project the video for you. So before I bring in my co-host, I'll just introduce what the event actually is. And so let me just kind of pull up the information here and switch gears. So this is quite exciting. We always want to incorporate music components. We've had, of course, live music, and this year we're having pre-recorded music.